Well, good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you. Welcome to church on what is a really special day. It's a busy day here as well. We are going to be worshiping in a moment our Savior Jesus, who this morning is on his way to Jerusalem and is on his way to the cross. And we're going to wave palm branches, and we are going to celebrate as crowds sang and celebrated then. But we remember also what was just around the corner in a few days. There is a sense of this celebration being overshadowed by what is to come. And all of that we will reflect on this morning. We're also going to be gathering after this service for our church members meeting, and that is for those who are in regular membership with us, but also if you are new to church, if you've been with us just for a little while, if you've wondered what membership is about and want to know a little bit more about what we are thinking about as a church, what plans we're making and how we talk about those plans, it would be wonderful if you could join us. So there's going to be a short break after this morning's service. There'll be time for us to grab a drink, have some lunch if we've brought food with us, and then we'll move into that members' meeting. As well as being Palm Sunday, this is a significant day as well, because it's the first time we've gathered as a church since we heard the news during the week of Sally's passing. And so we would ask you, just remind you, as I'm sure you've all been doing, please do remember Thomas and Stefan and Jerry in your prayers. And we will hopefully share more news with you soon about Sally's funeral service when we're able to put those arrangements in place. But they are so appreciative of all the love and support that has been shown and continues to be shown. Shall we take a moment and we'll pray for them now? Our loving God, it is hard to gather, having prayed, having sought you, all of us struggled to come to terms these last 2 weeks with our dear sister Sally being taken so suddenly ill right in this place, right among us. And now we come to terms with the news that she is no longer with us here, but she is with you. Now she sees fully, now she sees face to face. Oh, loving God, please be near us in our loss, and please especially would you be very near to Thomas, to Stefan, and Jerry. We have reflected in recent weeks on you as the God of all comfort. Would you comfort them? Would you be incredibly near to them this morning and in days to come? This Easter, may they know and may we know the fullness, the reality of hope in resurrection and the difference that you make as you go to die for us and as you are raised to life. And all this we ask in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you, friends. We're going to worship our great God together now, and Dewig is going to lead us in our first song. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Good morning. It's good to see your faces. Another week. And we're going to stand to our feet at this time, and we are going to be raising our banners. We've got some palm leaves on the chairs, and there's some instruments dotted around. So if you'd like to find yourself an instrument, if there's a basket that can go around with the instruments so people can take something out, and there's one at the back. Let's hear them shaking for a while before we get into the swing of the song. Okay, raise your banners.
Raise your banner to proclaim King Jesus. Raise your banner to the King of Kings. Shout Hosanna to the one who saves us. Shout Hosanna as we welcome him.
shout Hosanna. Hosanna!
Hosanna. Sing your praises to proclaim King Jesus. Sing your praises to the King of Kings. Lift your voice to the one who saves us. Lift your voices as we welcome him. Raise your banner to proclaim King Jesus. Raise your banner to the King of Kings. Shout Hosanna to the one who saves us. Shout Hosanna as we welcome him. Dance in rhythm to proclaim King Jesus. Dance in rhythm to the King of Kings. We're all singing to the one who saves us. We're all singing as we welcome him.
Okay, I want to see your banners lifted really high. Yeah, that's good.
Raise your banner to proclaim King Jesus. Raise your banner to the King of Kings. Shout Hosanna to the one who saves us. Shout Hosanna as we welcome him. Shout Hosanna as we welcome him. Shout Hosanna as we welcome him.
Can we shout Hosanna? Hosanna! Amen.
Just got very short readings. The first one from Zechariah, and that's chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And then Matthew 18, verse 20. For where two or three come together in my name, there am I with them.
Hear me. Can you hear me? I just wanted to encourage us here. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in spirit. And I just wanted to ask that you would allow that scripture to rest on your heart at this time. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in spirit. Somebody needed to hear that today. Right now, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in spirit. We are all feeling a bit crushed in spirit. And we want to know that the Lord is near to us, a very present help in this time of need. Amen, church? Amen. So just feel his presence resting on you. There's been many losses, even we've experienced a loss this week. There's been many unspoken things that are going on at this particular time. But we just want to know that the Lord is near and he brings hope. Amen?
Amen?
He brings hope. We are not like those that mourn, that don't know Christ. We know Christ and we mourn, but we are comforted. We are comforted because we know that he has gone to prepare a place for us. If it wasn't so, he wouldn't have told us this. So know that the Lord has prepared a place for us, and one day we will meet our loved ones again and embrace them again. The Lord is near to you this morning. He's near. And we've come to worship him. We've come to ask him to be near. So we're going to stand and we're going to put our trust in him this morning. And we're going to sing, we are here to worship him. Can't remember the name of the song, but we're going to sing. He's here, moving in our midst. If we could stand, let's stand and experience that move right now, right here for you. Because he's a way maker. He's a miracle worker, a and he's a promise keeper. So what he said that he will do, be assured that he will do it, because he's not a liar.
That is who you are. That is who you are.
Amen. Even when you don't see it, he's working. He never stops working. He never stops working. And we're so grateful that he doesn't stop working. Could you imagine if he did? Where we would be today, so lost and alone. But he assures us that he never stops working. So just take a few moments in that your time just to thank him and give him some praise and appreciation for all that he is doing and will do and has done. So Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that you never stop working. Lord, even when we don't see it and when we don't understand, Lord God, Lord, when we're confused and we're disappointed and we're lost and we're upset and hurt, Lord God, Father, you never stop working. You never stop working. Amen. There will be glory after this, Lord Jesus. After all that we pass through, there will be glory after this, Lord God. I pray that you'll continue to draw your people into your presence, Lord Jesus, in this time, that they will cry out to you. They will find you and they seek you and they seek you with their whole hearts, Lord. You are near. You are near. For those that don't know you, Lord God, I pray that they will come to have a relationship with you, Lord Jesus. It is your heart's desire that we would serve you, Lord God, that we put our hope and our trust in you, Lord Jesus. Father, you have so much to give us, to bless us with, Lord, to direct us and to ensure that we have a fruitful and satisfying life in you, Lord. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. May we taste today, Lord, whatever we're facing. May we taste of you this day and see that you are good. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Seated. So, it's Palm Sunday. We are going to reenact what happened those few thousand years ago. So welcome to our unrehearsed but perfect sketch this morning of Palm Sunday. And we have got a very special person with us this morning. So welcome Jesus. Everybody wave your palm branches. Hey. Shout Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest.
I'm lost.
Well, come this way.
I think you'll find it's just here. Just here. It's a pleasure. All right. After Jesus said these things, he went up to Jerusalem. When he got close to Bethpage and Bethany at a place called the Mount of Olives, he called two of his disciples. Have we got any disciples?
The two disciples. We need two disciple volunteers.
We need two disciples, please. If you don't volunteer, we will do it for you.
We will pick on you.
There you go. Jesus chooses his disciples. Excellent.
Wonderful. Yes.
Bring your palm branch with you. You'll need it. Lovely. Okay. Are we ready? Okay. And he gave them the following orders. Go into the village up ahead. When you get there, you will find a young donkey. Aha.
Okay, we need
donkeys.
Two young donkeys
young
this
donkey.
Morning. Yes, one, two, come in.
Come with us.
And are there some more with some masks?
The We've got more, but have we more donkeys? Always love a donkey.
Wonderful, come, donkeys. Come forward, yes.
If you've got the masks from the table, would you be able to bring them up with you or
come
give them
forward.
To somebody else?
Yeah.
You can come and be the donkey owner. That's brilliant. Well done.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Come and
yes,
look after your donkeys.
Masks. We need
come and
those
keep
masks.
Them in check. Make sure they're behaving.
Mm.
Okay.
Okay, we have the donkeys. Excellent.
And do these donkeys make any sounds?
They go, eat-aw.
But I think everyone.
I think we need to get everyone doing that this morning.
Not just in spirit, but actually
so you're
going to
tell
voice,
everyone what to do.
Because they're shy donkeys. Okay.
So we all
Let's
go,
practice.
Eat-aw.
Eat-aw.
Very good donkeys.
Right. So as I said, Jesus gave the disciples the following orders. Go into the village up ahead. When you get there, you will find a young donkey that has
Eat-aw.
Never been ridden. Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
So, it will be tied up, so you need to untie it, disciples, and bring it to me. So the disciples are going to find these beautiful, sweet, unridden donkeys and take them back to Jesus.
And then the donkey owner says...
If the owner asks, why are you untying my donkey? I think everyone's going to be a donkey owner. Would you
absolutely
all please ask, why are you
untying
my
donkey?
Simply tell him, the Lord needs it. The Lord needs it. That's what I'm... Yes. So the donkey owner gives a perfect answer. The Lord needs it. The disciples did as Jesus told them. They went into the village. They found the young donkeys. And they started to untie them. But as they did so, the owner came up and asked,
Why are you untying my donkey?
And just as Jesus told them to do, they replied,
The Lord needs it.
Excellent. Then the two disciples brought the young donkeys.
Eeyore!
Have we got any hooves?
Oh, we do.
Yes. We're going to have a sounder armor as well.
Make some noise.
That's it. So there we are. The disciples have brought the young donkeys to Jesus. You'll have to imagine this. But they put their cloaks on the young donkey's back. Jesus sits on the donkey, and off he rode. Come on. As Jesus rode along, you can mime this bit, people spread their cloaks on the road.
Whoosh.
Take your cloak off and spread it on the road. In front of him. There we go. Gracefully ridden, young Jesus, gracefully ridden. They reached the path that led down from the Mount of Olives into Jerusalem, whichever you choose. And the whole multitude of disciples, this is everybody, you will see the greenery, grab some greenery please, absolutely everyone.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lovely branch there. That
wave your palms.
So the whole multitude of disciples began to shout praises to Jesus for all the powerful things they had seen him do.
Blessed is the King,
name of the King
who comes in God's name. Hosanna in the highest.
When the Pharisees heard this, were not very happy.
No. We need a couple of Pharisees.
We do need the Pharisees.
Or we could just have everyone
shake their hands. Or should we just shake their hands?
So let's not single out the
Tell your disciples to be quiet.
Tell your disciples to be quiet.
To which Jesus simply replied, if you manage somehow to quiet this lot, the stones themselves would shout out.
And you all say, you can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you might just find you get what you need.
I know, which was actually truer than any of them knew. What Jesus actually meant, of course, was that the stones would shout out his praises too. So let's do that all together. Are the words going to come up? Or they will.
Everyone all together will say, Blessed is the King who comes in God's name. Hosanna in the highest. Thank you very much. Well done.
Well done, everybody.
Absolutely wonderful. Okay. And thank you to Jesus and our wonderful disciples and our wonderful donkeys. Another round of applause for them as well.
Yeah.
And thank you, Rosemary, for narrating so beautifully.
Just before the offering, if you've got younger ones with you, we would love to offer you an activity
particularly while there's some chatting going on, if they're starting to get fidgety. So there's some bits over on each side. So do feel free to get out of your seats, go and get them. And if you can complete those things, come and see me afterwards, because there will be some special prizes. So there's all sorts of things on either side. If you get really, really, really fidgety, and that's any age, you can have a little walk out the back, but make sure Trevor doesn't know you're doing that in his talk. And there's some things to do out there. But can you please make sure you've got somebody with you? Thank you.
Wonderful. And I believe the worship band are now going to come back up, and we're going to sing our praises to God.
I think it's the offering.
If we'd like to stand to our feet again. Can we just shout Hosanna one more time? It sounds so nice. Hosanna! Amen.
Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. You know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through. We do. Wish that they could see it all they knew. We do. Is all creation groaning? Coming, it is. Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
Amen.
It is. Open the scroll, the Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend us?
Thank you, Lord.
Is anyone holy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. Slave for every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest.
praise to God, to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is.
Oh, gracious God, you are worthy. I mean, what a wonderful God you are. And we think of the heavenly chorus with whom we join in that heavenly throne room. And they sing of your worthiness, because it was you who died and you who was raised to life. Just think of that incredible picture of Luke. You know, the people are told to look at the Lion of Judah and they see you as a lamb instead. It's too much for us to comprehend. And here we are, we join with those praises now. We're so thrilled to offer you our thanks. And we offer you our thanks in our song and in these gifts. And we pray that they would be used so that others would know how great you are, how worthy you are, that many others would be blessed. And all this we ask in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Friends, thanks. Please take a seat. Just a couple of announcements. One really is to reiterate what I've already said, that we do have our church meeting immediately after this service. We're going to be reflecting on some further decisions about our building. We're going to be looking back and thinking about our sermon series in 1 Peter and talking about what we think we've learned from that. And as I said, even if you're not a member but you'd like to join us, and just see how we make our decisions and be part of our contribution, our conversation, and give us your perspective as well. We'd be really good if you could join us. And we'll take a break for a little while after the service, grab some coffee, grab some food, then we'll come back together again. The only other announcement I want to make is to remind you about what's going on in church this week around Holy Week. So we're going to be gathering in here in the sanctuary every night at 7:30, just for half an hour for reflections. We're going to be sharing some simple prayers and liturgy. We'll read a little bit of the Holy Week story from John's Gospel. And we'll then reflect and pray together. And there'll be different voices leading that. I think Katie's leading tomorrow evening, the first of those. So please do join us. I think it's really good if we can not just be here on Palm Sunday and then get to Good Friday or Easter Day. If we can walk the whole journey of the week, it's such a good thing to do. The only other thing I wanted to mention was about Easter Day, Easter morning. We will be gathering in the coffee lounge for a short and simple communion service at 8 o'clock. And then there'll be breakfast served here at 9 o'clock. If you come to communion, you can stay on. You can arrive at 9 and have a simple breakfast before we worship God together as a family at 10:30 in our all-age service. If you are coming for breakfast, it would be really helpful if you could sign your name just to give us an idea of how many people we're catering for. And there's a sign-up sheet. It's quite distinctive. It's a yellow sheet, which is outside. It's on the notice board in the foyer. That would be great if you could let us know if you're coming. So we're going to listen to Scripture now. We're going to listen to two readings, one from John 12, John's account of what happens on Palm Sunday, and then a reading from John 2, which comes earlier in John's Gospel, but is actually about what happens just after the triumphal entry. And thanks to Teresa and Hilary, who will bring those to us. Thanks.
Good morning, church. Right, we've got another opportunity to say Hosanna in this passage. So you can, as I say Hosanna, you might want to wave your palms. Okay, so we're going to be reading from John 12, 12 to 19. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had performed this sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him. Amen.
And our second reading actually goes back in John's Gospel, but this is something that happened after Jesus had arrived in Jerusalem. So reading from John chapter 2, verses 13 to 25. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market. His disciples remembered that it's written, Zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then responded to him, What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this? Jesus answered them, Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days. They replied, It's taken 46 years to build this temple. You're going to raise it in 3 days? But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now, while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many people saw the signs he was performing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. He did not need human testimony about them, for he knew what was in them. Amen.
Wonderful. Thanks, Hilary and Teresa. Now, we're going to think about these words in just a moment. I'm not going to talk for very long this morning, but as I begin, I thought I'd pose a question. And it might seem a strange one to ask you, particularly on a morning like this, but there's a point to it. I promise, there always is. Have you ever had moments in your life where you felt overcome by jealousy? And have there even been moments in your life where maybe you thought that jealousy was an appropriate thing? It was the appropriate response to whatever was going on around you. Now, even as I asked that question, I realized it might seem a bit shocking because most of us, we probably agree that most of the time to be jealous is not a good thing. If I go home today and I see, I don't know, a brand new expensive car in my neighbor's driveway, or some other shiny possession, and I'm immediately filled with thoughts of, oh, I wish I had that. Oh, how could I get that? I want it. That's not a good place for me to be in. And we probably all know, jealousy is a really strong emotion. There are some emotions that kind of once they get a grip on you, they get under your skin. And they can just have a capacity or a means of dominating our thinking. You with me? If you get jealous, it can take you away to places you hadn't imagined you could go in quite a short period of time. I don't know if you ever studied it at school, or if you know the story, or maybe you've even seen it, but one of the most famous plays that Shakespeare wrote is one called Othello, and you could say it's all about jealousy. That's the great theme of the play, and one of the most famous lines in the play is spoken as a warning to Othello, and it goes like this: "Oh, beware, my lord, of jealousy. It is the green-eyed monster." You heard that expression? What's that old gag? Problem with Shakespeare, it's full of cliches. But that was a joke, don't worry, I'll just think about it. But, and if you know that, if you know the play, there is a really sad and horrible sense of irony to that line, because the warning is given by Iago, who is actually trying to mess with Othello's head and is stoking his jealousy, and all the while warning him about it. So as I said a minute or two ago, most of us, we probably think that jealousy is not a good thing. We might even have had experiences of dealing with people who are jealous. And we know that in their worst moments, they can quickly become obsessive or even suspicious. And yet, here's the thing. When we open our Bibles and we turn to the Old Testament, there are a number of occasions when God speaks of himself as being jealous. I'm sure most of us will remember one of these because it's one of the best known passages in the whole of the Old Testament. It's the Ten Commandments. And very near the beginning of that list, this is what God says to Israel. He says, "You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." And it's as if God is saying to Israel in this moment, he's just delivered them out of captivity. He says, "I have such love for you, and I desire such love in return. And because of that, I cannot abide the thought that you would give your love or your devotion to anyone else. I can't have it. I can't even begin to go there. The thought that you might go after any other god, that you might give the love that I want from you to someone else." And the thing is, this is not the only time God speaks in this way. If you have a concordance or a study Bible with a list of words you can look up at the end. If you read the Bible on an app on your phone and it's got like a search function, go and type that word jealous into it, and it comes up lots of times. It's not just in one or two places. There's just one more example I thought I'd share from the book of Zechariah. "Proclaim this word," the prophet says. This is what the Lord Almighty says: "I'm very jealous for Jerusalem and Zion because I love it and I care for it and I want to protect it and I want it to be there for the places and the purposes and a sense of holiness like I always wished it would be." And I think when you look at those verses, you get a glimpse of how strongly God feels for his people. One of the leaders of the early church, Augustine, who was a famous bishop, he once said this: "He who is not jealous does not love." You might want to reflect on that when you look at those other verses. And I think we probably recognize what he's saying. When you love someone, when you really really love someone, it's not a shrug your shoulders, whatever kind of emotion, is it? It's not. It's not easy come, easy go. When you love someone, it gets under your skin. You feel intensely and passionately about that person. And it seems to me that it's that same kind of love, that intense, earnest, heartfelt love, this love that says things have to be a particular way because I care so much. It's that sort of love that you read about when Jesus goes into Jerusalem and he goes to the temple in John 2. Here is Jesus. It's the beginning of Holy Week. And he walks, do you remember the story? He walks into the temple precinct and he discovers this scene that just appalls him. And something instinctively rises up in him. He is so angry because instead of prayer, you've got all this buying and selling and exchanging of money. And instead of people being welcomed and offered sanctuary, there are people looking to make money out of them. Do you ever go to sort of like spectator experiences or big events and you think, oh, everywhere I go, it's just they've overpriced the drinks and they've overpriced the food and they're saying, I have to buy this and I have to buy that and I'm having to put my hand in my pocket all the time. I'm just being milked. It was like that in the temple in Jerusalem. Here's what you have to pay for a certain kind of animal that could be sacrificed. Here's a levy that you might have to pay because there's only a certain currency that is used in the temple precinct and you need to change your cash. Everywhere, money being made. And Jesus looks at all of this and just thinks, no. And, you know, I realize lots of us will have read this many times before, but when you think about it, it is so shocking to pick up a whip. I mean, does he take the whip in with him? Does he plan this? I don't know. To turn over tables. It's quite a shocking thing to do. It's as if something in Jesus breaks and he's overcome by his sense that this is not how things should be. And then John describes all of this. And then he offers this explanation of what's taken place. That his disciples remembered that it's written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Now, the verse that they're quoting is from Psalm 69, and if you were to go back, if you were to read the original Hebrew, you'd find that actually that word, which is translated as zeal for your house will consume me, it's actually the same word that God uses to speak of his jealousy in the Ten Commandments. So effectively, you could say it's the same issues which are at stake here. And just as God tells the people of Israel that he feels such intense love for them that he can't abide any of them worshiping anyone else, Jesus feels this just deep distress. That here he is in the temple and God is not being given the priority that he ought to have. I wonder what we think about this. What do you think of God being jealous in this way? To think of Jesus feeling so strongly. Zeal is a very strong word. Feels like quite an extreme word. And I think we live in a time when to have extreme emotions is almost frowned upon. You know, we go to great lengths to stop people having extreme views. But what's the alternative to a God who feels so strongly about us? The alternative is surely a God who's indifferent, God who doesn't care. What sort of God would that be? So he goes and he feels this anger and he turns over tables and something wells up inside him. And it's his love. Remember, somebody once saying years ago, anger is not the opposite of love. The opposite of love is hatred, and the ultimate form of hatred is indifference. Jesus feels this love. It's just one more thought, and it occurred to me as I read this passage, and as I was thinking again about the words from that psalm, the words Jesus says that disciples remember when they think about Jesus in the temple precinct. Do they remember them at the time, or do they remember them when they've had conversations years later? But remember again the words. His disciples remember that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Now, when you think about it, those words could actually work on a couple of different levels, couldn't they? On the one hand, they could say, they could be a description of just how emotional Jesus is at that moment. This sort of really deep level of distress. You know, we all might have moments where I lost my temper and I would say, I was just consumed by rage. You with me? And yet I think, actually, you can understand those words at a deeper level. Because could it be that in speaking, that he is speaking also, John, of this intense sense of protectiveness, this passion Jesus feels for the house of God, this longing he feels for the people of God to turn back to God and to be restored to right relationship with God. And he knows this is actually going to be the cause of Jesus' very death, this love. Zeal for your house and my love for my people and my love for people everywhere will actually consume me because I will die because of this love. In a few days' time, I will go to the cross because of this love. And he knows that all of this must be done if he's to put things right, if he's to rebuild the temple. Remember, rebuild the temple in 3 days. And you might think at that moment, remember what we thought about in 1 Peter a couple of weeks ago when he says, I'm going to rebuild the temple in 3 days. And everyone goes, no, you're not. How can that happen? It's going to be building something new. It's going to be building us. He's going to be building out of living stones with him as the cornerstone. When he goes to that cross, he's going to make possible the birth of a whole new people, a whole new movement, a way in which his love is put on display with living stones, with a church that people can see and look at and think that's different. So I just wonder if you see in this moment more than a man getting cross, more than a man being upset, more than somebody who is distressed at the lack of a certain kind of protocol, you catch a glimpse instead of the most remarkable love, the love of God. And yes, this love is a jealous love and a strong love and a passionate love, but it's a love as well. It lives itself out in giving all, in giving of everything that can possibly be given in order for us to come back into relationship. This is the zeal of God that takes Jesus to the cross. What are we to make of this? How God loves us so much, he would do anything to bring us back to him. Anything. I mean anything. So think of Jesus this morning, and he's going into Jerusalem, and he knows he's traveling to his cross. We saw wonderfully enacted that great drama that Pete and others did for us. He knows what is ahead of him, and he goes, and he goes. And he keeps moving towards his cross because he wants to keep moving towards us. Shall we pray? Oh, Lord, what love. I mean, what remarkable love you have for us. It's incredible. You know, we think of moments when we might have had to face a cost, face some difficulty, face a hard decision, face a sacrifice. We struggle with it. And we know that we will read in days to come of your struggle also, of how this was so difficult and intensely difficult, of moments when you were troubled, of moments when you were on your own in that garden and facing the enormity of it all, and yet you did this thing for us. We are so thankful. I pray that you make us people who return to you a love worthy of yours, who return to you a love which is passionate and which is eager and which is always looking for ways that we might love you more and show you more of our devotion, our service, show others more of your love. Be with us, we pray, not just today as we worship and make decisions, but each day that lies ahead in this week. May we know you near, and may we stay near to you. Amen. Thank you.
We're going to be singing our final song. If you'd like to stand to your feet. And as you stand to your feet, let's say another Hosanna. Let's just take the opportunity throughout the day to shout Hosanna to the King of Kings. So after three, we're going to say a big Hosanna. One, two, three.
Hosanna. Hosanna.
Can we make it bigger than that? One, two, three.
Hosanna. Hosanna.
Absolutely. That sounds fantastic in my ears and also in the Lord's. Amen.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, the people sing. To take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray.
In the highest.
Friends, before we share a blessing together, just a reminder there'll be tea and coffee available after the service. And there's also space here where if you want to pray for anything that's come up in the service or anything on your heart as you've come here today, and people will be here to pray with you. Shall we share a blessing? Yeah.
The time is not yet, but the darkness is gathering.
The time is not yet, but the main players are taking their positions.
Dither not, but come back tomorrow and wait with the Son of God, for his friends are few in this world of hatred.
The time is not yet, but our time is now to be here and trust a love that will see this thing through.
Go, but be back, for Jesus needs his friends.
Amen. Yeah.